Welcome to Putting It Together, the podcast that goes through the entire body of work of Stephen Sondheim, show by show and song by song. My name is Kyle Marshall, your self-described Sondheim expert. You know, I think everybody gets to that point in their life where at least somebody that you know comes up to you and lets you know that it's time to grow up. And I'm giving you permission to punch them in the neck. I mean, context does matter, and I'm not advocating anyone to go and get arrested, but me and my guest here this week, Lucas Rougeux, kind of get into all of the minutiae of what it means to grow up, and of course, what it means inside of this song from Merrily We Roll Along. We'll be getting to that in just a moment, but I thought it would be appropriate to read from an email that I just recently received. What's pretty cool is that I get messages all the time now of people who are just stumbling across the podcast and have decided to go and listen to it chronologically, which I can't really advise because I'm kind of embarrassed of those first early episodes, but that's, you know, beside the point. Regardless, people then like to comment and talk about episodes that are from like 1, 2, 3 years ago. Charlotte sent this in to talk specifically about Follies, one of her absolute favorite Sondheim shows. Specifically, I thought this part was really interesting. Have you noticed the parallels between Follies and A Midsummer Night's Dream? I'm very curious about this and don't see it talked about a lot. The four tangled love lives, the sudden reversals in who is pursuing whom, fairies slash ghosts of the past influencing the plot unseen, ending with a play within a play, the sense of the Follies being a supernatural space like the forest. To me, the parallels seem too close to be purely coincidence. I'm not sure what the significance of this is, but I think it should be discussed more. So, throwing up to the people who are listening to this right now in present day, do you think there's something to this? I do think that there's an interesting parallel that we could start to make between Shakespeare's A Midsummer Night's Dream and how Follies is constructed. There does seem to be some through lines. I'm just trying to figure out who Puck is. Anyways, let's get into growing up, my discussion with Lucas Rougeux, right now. Lucas Rougeux, thank you so much for coming back.
Thank you so much for dragging me back, Kyle.
I know. Just came over and just grabbed you by the lapels and dragged you onto the episode here. What is your history with Merrily We Roll Along?
I have mostly you to thank for that. Prior to you bringing me back on the show, I hadn't really known much about Merrily We Roll Along. I think that was one of those shows that the whispered about, like, really talk about, we don't talk about the strange
in the shadows, yeah.
And I had heard songs here or there. I think the biggest one is Not a Day Goes By. I mean, hearing Bernadette Peters sing it for, I believe it was like when she was in the birthday concert, the Ladies in Red section.
Yep, does it there. She also does it in her concerts, I think, all the time too. So if you've ever seen Bernadette Peters in concert, you'll hear her sing it.
Yes, and I am certainly a big sucker for like melancholic ballads, so that really scratched an itch for me. But other than that, I was just like, oh, that's a nice song. I don't know where it's from, but anyways. But it wasn't until you suggested that I come back on the show that I really decided to sit down, watch the show, listen to various recordings, and what a journey it's been.
Well, so for you then, being, I will say, like, relatively new coming into Merrily We Roll Along, have you seen a production, like a film production or anything?
Yes. You pointed me to the Great Performances, I think 2013 production.
Yeah.
And I watched that like once and a half. And that's a great production. I think originally I started like trying to listen to the recording. So I'm like, no, I need to see what's going on to really get it. This show is, I don't know, pretty unusual. And knowing that it goes backwards in time, I was really intrigued by that prospect. I think I think some of your other guests have talked about liking this sort of subversive storytelling form. And I think my love of, at being an artist and love of poetry. Like I love ways of taking original forms and turning them on their head. So I think the idea of the show is really fascinating. But I think there are a lot of moments in the show that really shine through as perhaps not Sondheim's best work. Mm-hmm. I think perhaps the show being a show about show business seems very like hat on a hat to me, a very like on the nose, I guess. And I think that's something that I was just kind of like a little over it.
It does feel a little bit, I mean, not to throw him completely under the bus, but if anyone is a Stephen King fan out there, it's like, but what if my main character was an author? That's what I'll do.
It's like, yep.
It happens a lot.
Yeah, literally. I had a brief stint of reading Stephen King books back to back, and literally every main character, there was a struggling writer.
Yeah.
Write what you know, I guess, huh?
For Merrily here, then, I mean, the big question that I've been asking every single person who's come onto the show is whether or not you consider this a failure. So I'll pose that to you. Do you think Merrily is a failure?
I don't think so. I mean, I definitely don't think so. It certainly has a lot of like really interesting ideas. And I think above all, the music is phenomenal. I think my favorite part of the show in general is the music. The horns are so energizing. Like, it's such an energizing show from the music. The book writing and the characters are leave something to be desired. But I think the ideas are really universal, and I think are really engaging. And I think a musical that is so subversive in the storytelling and really switches up how we are looking at a story, how we're looking at a narrative, and how we're utilizing music and songs and the musical structure differently, I think that's really fascinating. I think it's really interesting. Mm-hmm. So I don't think it's a failure. And I think it's very important, I think, for Sondheim to have done it in the first place.
Yes.
It's not his best, but I don't think it's a failure.
Not to sound like a broken record here too much, but it's not my favorite Sondheim. It would probably not feature into my top 5 or top 8 of the shows that he's done, but definitely would not be what I would consider one of the worst shows that he's been a part of.
Yeah.
Are there any themes specifically that draw you in or that are interesting to you within the show?
I think there are a lot of like comparisons to other ideas of other shows that I think are a little bit more successful. And I think the ideas of pursuing dreams and pursuing art and your passions, I think, is a really important and exciting theme. I think perhaps the consistent like repetition of even just the word dream in the musical, I think, is gets a little bit like, okay. But I'm very intrigued by the ideas of what it means to pursue your dreams, what it means to sort of have to compromise sometimes and have to struggle through all life throws at you, and trying to make these sort of idealized dreams come true, if at all. Like, I think that it's a really interesting idea. I think that's an idea that Sondheim eventually does really well with Sunday. I mean, grappling it with in many different contexts, but pursuing art and pursuing your passions, I think, is well covered in Sunday, more so than here. But I like that idea. I like that theme, even if it seems a little naive to be talking about dreams, which I think we will certainly get into with this song too.
I try not to psychoanalyze the man himself too much, but it is fascinating to me when you look at his 80s output, basically up until Assassins in 1990, and there must have been something just in the back of his mind that he was really wrestling with for that 10 years or so, because he repeatedly comes back to, in 4 successive shows, the idea of moments and dreams. And it feels like he kind of starts to grasp with it here more fully in Sunday, but then like that becomes like moments become so important as the thing that he's grappling with in Into the Woods. And then dreams are what he's grappling with in Assassins. So it's really interesting to hear the start of that here and to where that grows into a more fully fleshed out show.
Yeah, I would even argue too that Sweeney has a little bit of that brewing too of the ambition, I think. You know, Sweeney's ambition and Sweeney's just relentless like drive and focus, I think, is a precursor to thinking about these like these things that are going to be happening in the future, these goals that we're sort of yearning for, even though it's a very sinister goal in Sweeney.
He is just a small business owner trying to get by.
He is. That's exactly it. Yes.
What song are we talking about here this week, Lucas?
Well, we're talking about growing up. We're not kids anymore. We're adults. We're going to be growing up and growing into the world.
In part, I think one of the reasons why I wanted to pair you with this song, knowing that you're an artist, I guess I don't know, but has that been something that has been said to you at all? Like, oh, you should grow up and not pursue this.
Oh, yeah. I think that has been such an underlying idea, even since I was a kid, which is so sad that, like, the pursuit of arts or pursuit of, like, visual arts is this very childlike and naive pursuit. I mean, like, the idea that making art is reserved for children and reserved for people that are just playing around, and that this pursuit is not really contributing worth to society, which I disagree with, but so many people don't see the utilitarian worth of visual arts in particular, but a lot of the arts in general. A lot of the struggle when I was a teenager and in high school, and then eventually driving into going into college and figuring out what I wanted to pursue in the college, my parents were consistently trying to, like, subtly Mrs. Lovety sort of suggest more lucrative paths for me to pursue, of like, oh yeah, you can do art on the side, but, like, at some point you have to, like, think of something, you know, more lucrative or comfortable or whatever that'll, you know, contribute to society in ways that art won't. So that's been an idea that I've been grappling with for some time. I think at some point you have to realize that, like, the idea that removing yourself from childhood or a childlike sensibility is not always a good thing, that having a sense of wonder and excitement and playfulness, I think, you know, a lot of artists really like to embrace that. And I think that's sometimes a really great thing, that, you know, the harshness of life and reality is need some playfulness and fun and relief and creation.
I think that's one of the subtle things that's being explored in this song, specifically with Frank himself. I think he's got it in his head that what growing up means is doing things you don't want to do, which,
yeah,
to an extent is what growing up is. It's like, you do have to take, like, pay taxes, or you have to figure out electrical and all this other stuff in your life. It's like, oh, why do I have to, like, do this? But within his art output, it's interesting that that's what he figures he has to do. It's like, well, I can't do the stuff that I actually want to do. I have to do this other type of art that is more lucrative.
Yeah, and certainly when we get to it in the song, I wonder how much that is an idea that he has himself thought of or has come up with himself, or is it, if it's just a lingering of what other people, particularly Gussie, has planted in him as this idea that you have to compromise your entire creative output in its entirety, rather than just kind of selecting what you should be pursuing and what you should be sort of compromising on.
It's Joe Josephson. He was like, you need a tune you can hum, boy.
Exactly. And then he's like, you need a tune you can hum. Well, I guess I've not been an artist anymore. Damn it.
You called me out.
Yeah.
To put you on the hot seat here a bit, what is happening right before this song starts?
Well, we're lovingly singing about being old friends.
True.
Which, very ironically, the song Old Friends, which I believe that's the actual song, right? Old Friends, that not any sort of reprise. Yeah. It is an argument. It's Frank, I believe, has found a sort of business deal where Charlie and him can work together and make something perhaps lucrative, but not necessarily artistically fulfilling, particularly for Charlie, and or at least in Charlie's point of view. And there is now a sort of standstill of Frank has the opportunity to go and be with Charlie and Mary and go back to almost how things were and make art. And as Charlie says, make art and the money will come. But Frank is sort of lured by the idea of making money, thinking that that is what success means. So he's torn between going to be with Mary and Charlie and being torn to perhaps go the more lucrative success business side, which Gussie, I think, is a representative of.
Yeah, this is kind of the crossroads moment. From my reading, at least, is what we're supposed to take away from this is Old Friends has just happened. It's kind of rekindled this idea, like, hey, yeah, maybe I should spend more time with the people I was hanging out with here before. They invite him to go to this club, and he's like, yeah, okay, I'm going to come. Not super committed, but, like, he agrees to. And then Gussie is the one who's like, well, maybe you don't have to. Maybe you can keep staying with me.
Yes.
Because also, kind of in the scene, she is fully left her husband. She finally comes out and is like, I've left my husband, I'm only going to be with you. So this affair that they've been having is now going to become out in the open, even though everyone kind of knows it's happening.
Yes. Yeah.
Hey everyone, just Kyle breaking into the conversation to tell you about some of the people and places that help this show continue to go. If you'd like to help support this show for absolutely free, you can give a rating and review on whatever app you listen to podcasts in. It's of course greatly appreciated. And if you'd like to help monetarily, which will only help to grow and make this show better, you can do so over at our Patreon page. Please do not donate if it impacts you negatively financially. I should also give a huge thank you to the God That's Good tier from Patreon. That's Jack, Todd, Robert, Louise, Christopher, and Steven. And I do want to give a huge thank you to another Christopher who just signed up for the Patreon this week. Putting Together is a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network, locally grown, community supported. The Alberta Podcast Network promotes and supports Alberta-made podcasts and connects their audiences with Alberta-based businesses and organizations. This episode of Putting It Together is brought to you by Alberta Blue Cross. Even if you're a busy business owner with more meetings than hours in a day, you are calm and collected when your group benefit plan is taken care of by Alberta Blue Cross. Your employees can manage their own health, dental, life, and disability coverage online anytime on any device, making it easier for them and for you. To learn more and explore your options, you can head on over to ab.bluecross.ca. This week, we are also brought to you by Connect First Credit Union, but they have created their own commercial themselves, so let's go and have a listen to that.
Do you ever feel like just a number? A digit? A denominator? A decimal? Another cog in the big bank machine? Waiting on hold? Online? Never on time? And always on your dime? Like your worth is only calculated by your net worth. In a world full of numbers, it's nice to know there's a place where you're not one. Connect First Credit Union. Bank on a brighter future.
So yeah, let's get into the lyrics here. So I just wanted to take a small moment because there's some stuff musically that is happening here that I think we should call out.
Yeah.
As Frank is left alone, he's sitting at the piano and he starts to, you know, noodle around on the keyboard itself. The first thing that he plays is a riff that, maybe correct me if I'm wrong here, I mean, you hear it in Opening Doors. That's the piano riff he's playing throughout that song and nailing by the end of it. But it's also, I think, supposed to be a setup for Going Left with this show that they keep talking about. So it's like him returning back to that. Like, maybe there is something here about this riff that I can do.
Yeah, I think I read somewhere too, or like in a synopsis of what was going on, mm-hmm. it was written that him perhaps like composing something entirely new. Or something that's newer. And I was trying to comb through the score and try to find places where it does come up. And yeah, it is pretty early on. And of course, it then goes into, I believe, the sort of melody of Good Thing Going.
Yeah, that's what he, so it's like, he says that like, da-na-na-na-na-na.
Yep.
And then that's, you know, that's heard through Opening Doors. But then it's fully Good Thing Going is what he goes into.
Yeah, like it is this perhaps moment of like, ooh, let me noodle around and make something else or explore something that was more on the artistic, creative side of Frank that was certainly left in the past. And this is perhaps, I think, the first time we've really encountered both of these musical melodies, right?
Let me think about that. Good Thing Going, you hear a few times, so I have to always remember. It might be. It might be the first time that we're actually hearing
the full
melodies. Yes, I think you're right.
Yeah, so like it is this moment of,
I guess, other than the overture. The overture does have Good Thing Going in it.
True. But yeah, it is this musical moment where, you know, as the composer, he is not only mentally, obviously, like in the book scenes, thinking about the past and thinking about art for art's sake and the way that Charlie and Mary by comparison are wanting him to pull to, but he is musically toying with that idea of like, ooh, let me think about that.
Here's my question. And I feel like you, as an actor or director, you could play this in a few different ways, because the melody he's playing is not the melody that he's singing. So he's in this first bit, he's actually singing a completely different melody than what he's actually playing on the piano.
Yeah.
My question to you is this. I'm just talking about the very first bit, which I'll read out here right now, just so we're not talking around it. But the thanks, old friends, keep reminding me. Frank's old friends always seem to come through. Frank will too.
Thanks, old friends. Keep reminding me. Frank's old friends always seem to come through. Frank will too. So old friend.
Do you think that that is meant to be diegetic or non-diegetic? Meaning, is this a musical number within a musical? Or is he actually singing that bit for real? Just like Bobby, Jack, and Jack later in the show, when that is actually a thing that's being performed in front of people. So is he actually singing this at the piano? Or is this an internal monologue he is thinking about?
That's interesting. That is interesting. Like, yeah, I wonder how much... I mean, there are like through lines of moments, I think, where what he has written in the past does become memoir-esque or very akin to his own life. So I think that's not necessarily far-fetched of him sort of saying this very autobiographical or very personal thing, actually like singing it and thinking that it is a good melody. And him in the end of the next scenes, at like once we go back in time, is saying like, oh, divorce court would be a really interesting setting for a musical, which
I
think is so funny. So that is interesting. I never thought about that perhaps being something he is literally singing and perhaps composing.
And the only reason I bring that up too a little bit is that he also does like the little vocalizations, the like he's trying to like, he's not really fully even making musical phrases. He's like thinking about it, playing around with it. Not for the rest of the song, but for just this one moment, I'm like, are we meant to think that he's actually singing this at the piano?
Yeah, I mean, it is also like, I mean, the idea of old friends and having friends, like, you know, in the song previous, like there is the broad idea of having old friends, and that it does get into the specifics of obviously them and the arguments that they're having and the things that they're going through. But yeah, this first little bit is very broad, is an idea of like, thanks for reminding me of the good old times. And, you know, and Frank as the name in this little stanza here can be taken out as, you know, and replaced with some other name if it would be based into a show that he would eventually make.
That's what I love too, is that he is rhyming thanks with Franks, which is a fun little rhyme that he's playing with in these lyrics. So just to read out the rest of this first little section here. So there's that first part, and then it's, so old friends, now it's time to start growing up, taking charge, seeing things as they are, facing facts, not escaping them, still with dreams, just reshaping them, growing up.
So old friends, now it's time to start growing up, taking charge, seeing things as they are, facing facts, not escaping them, still with dreams, just reshaping them, growing up. Charlie is a hot
man. I was curious, we don't know this yet as audience members. This is our first time being introduced to this idea of growing up, as we alluded to before. And we don't quite know that it is an idea that perhaps Gussie planted in his mind. And I think particularly what I'm curious about is particularly the line, seeing things as they are. I was curious what your read on that line is, because I think there is a lot of moments in this song overall where he's saying things or alluding to things that he thinks he knows and perhaps not what they actually are, but like what he may think that they should be. I think there's a lot of underlying ideas in this song that he's alluding to something else, or so I'm curious what you think.
So I do have to recognize that I do have a lot of baggage when it comes to this phrase in particular, and I only bring that up because I've been in more than a few disagreements, arguments, we'll just say, with people about like, quote unquote, like the truth is.
Yeah.
And what you find out very, very quickly when people use phrases like that about like seeing things as they are, it's like you have to like face facts and like come to terms, like this is how the world works and this is how the things are. It's like, is it, or is that your opinion of how things are?
Yeah.
Not to get like too loosey-goosey with this, but it's the whole concept, right? You show a picture or have a scene and three different people are going to interpret it three different ways just based on where they're standing or their past or whatever it happens to be. And I think Frank is getting caught up in that in a way where he's like, you know, I have to face facts. Like, this is how the world works. I have to do it this way.
Yes.
And this comes back to my recurring theory that Frank is so obsessed with the future that he's not taking into account the present of what's actually happening. He's driving his friends away because he's so focused on his future goals of like wealth and power and stuff. There is literal examples in Hollywood, in the theater, wherever, where it's like, you don't have to do just one thing. You can kind of go back and forth if that's what you want to do. You don't always have to be so steadfast.
Yeah, he almost does sort of cement himself in this sort of closed-minded idea of like, this voice is very similar to like a very disgruntled dad that's like, grow up, face facts, find responsibility for yourself. Like he's almost being, I guess, like hard on himself. And like you alluded to earlier, it is him deciding like, oh, life is about making these tough choices and life is crap and you know, there's no fun in it anymore. And I was also curious, similar to a couple of the other lines too, still with dreams, just reshaping them. Frank has achieved some level of success. And I wonder what it means to have a dream, reach it to some extent. And then at that point, what do we do now? You know, and I wonder, still having dreams, just reshaping them, what was his dream in the first place? You know, or what did he think his dream was in the first place?
Yeah, this certainly is not a song that has like specifics necessarily thrown at us. It's a lot of like feelings and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And I think it should be stated too that I don't actually think anything that he's saying currently is even negative, like really, like. To use an extreme example, which I love to do to prove, try and prove points. If your house is on fire and you're sitting there and be like, the fire department's going to come. I'm like, well, no, like we kind of have to get out of the house. Like,
yeah.
You do have to face that kind of fact and like, okay, like there's bad things happening here. Let's go. But also just, you know, from my own life, like what your dreams are at 18 years old are not necessarily what your dreams are at 40. So those can change and reshape, and with new people in your life and new responsibilities, yeah, things can reshape and change. I think where it starts to become maybe a negative or it starts to corrupt you is like, in Frank's case, I'm only concerned about money. That's the only driving force that I'm doing. Or if it's like, I'm only thinking about myself and not other people. I think that's ultimately what's going on here. He's only thinking about himself and not anybody else in his life.
Yeah, absolutely. Definitely in the next section, he is really, I think when he starts talking about his friends, it is really very self-centered.
Two things I just wanted to mention before we jump into this next section. Number one, I kind of blew past this, but the whole reason this song even exists in this score, because it's not in the original Broadway cast. It doesn't exist in the original Broadway cast. This was a suggestion by James Lapine, who really helped reshape the 1985 version of Merrily We Roll Along. And he was basically like, Frank is an asshole for like 35 minutes of this show. We need to give the audience something a little bit quicker of like, oh, we get it. He's like, he is maybe more than what he is appearing to be.
Yeah, I listened to the original cast recording as I'm wont to do in general situations, not knowing how in depth or intense the rewrites were. So listening to that original was very jarring compared to the newer rewrites with this song and other songs in particular. And definitely gives Frank more depth than just being like the asshole. I still think he is displaying an asshole quality to him here, but he is grappling with something that I think a lot of us perhaps have grappled with, particularly people that are pursuing arts or artistic pursuits, where it's like, he eventually doesn't make the best decisions, one could argue, but these are questions and problems that a lot of us have struggled with, so.
Yeah, it's not him just being an asshole, he's actually struggling with these decisions.
Yeah, he's not being an asshole for the sake of being an asshole, he's struggling with whether or not he should be an asshole.
Right, like, that's right.
We'll give him that. Yeah, we'll give him that, making him a little bit
more. Which I resonate with a lot, I just want to say. So.
Yeah.
The other thing I just wanted to call out, I only thought about this this morning, actually. It's interesting tie-in to Franklin Shepard, Inc. that Charlie sings, because they both do the in kind of the same manner.
Yeah.
So it's an interesting tie-in to those two songs.
I didn't even notice that, but you're totally right. Yeah, that little hum along. And and you're right. Also in way back in Opening Doors, there's humming along and things like that. That is interesting that is a tie that I didn't even notice.
Let's get into this next section, which I want to call out as being so weird, so wild for a few different reasons. But just to read it out here first. Charlie is a hothead. Charlie won't budge. Charlie is a friend. Charlie is a screamer. Charlie won't bend. Charlie's in your corner. Mary is a dreamer. Mary's a friend. Mary is a nudge. Mary is a purist. Charlie's a judge. Charlie is a dropout. Everything's a cop-out. Why is it old friends don't want old friends to change? Every road has a turning. That's why you keep learning.
Charlie is a hothead. Charlie won't budge. Charlie is a friend. Charlie is a screamer. Charlie won't bend. Charlie's in your corner. Mary is a dreamer. Mary's a friend. Mary is a nudge. Mary is a purist. Charlie's a judge. Charlie is a dropout. Everything's a cop-out. Why is it old friends don't want old friends to change? Every road has a turning. That's the way you keep learning.
The form of how he's writing and talking about these friends in very like simple sentences, simple phrases, reminds me of lesson number 8 from Sunday. Mm-hmm, definitely mm-hmm. A different tone, like way different tone and use of that, but like that the simple like sentence structure that is almost repeating the structure of it but slightly altering it. I love that in terms of looking at poetry and looking at where that people are writing things, like, and especially a very Sondheimism, I think, in writing something that is seemingly very simple, but there are subtle changes that he's making that allude to something bigger.
One of the biggest things here that I just think is so buck wild is the rhyme scheme that's going on. Because for people who don't have it in front of them, there's 4 stanzas. The first 3 are 3 lines. The last one is 4. And initially I thought, wait a second, is he doing a sonnet? He's not. But for a quick second, I was like, oh, is that what's happening? Because it ends in a rhyming couplet.
Oh, true. It does end in a rhyming couplet.
I broke it out. And if we think about rhymes as being like, you know, A, B, A, B is like the A's rhyme, the B's rhyme, that sort of thing. The actual rhyme scheme to this is A, B, C, then D, C, E, then D, C, B, then F, back to B, G, G. That is how the rhyme scheme goes through this. So it has no rhythm. It doesn't really make sense about why he decides to rhyme certain things together and when he doesn't. It's, I think, truly bizarre how this is structured.
Well, I think it's very telling is to like why he's saying that, like what he's saying and why he's saying it like this. Like Frank is mulling things over in the first part of this song and just kind of like considering things. But I think then now he's back to the sort of mentality he was in perhaps in Old Friends or something that fired him up in Old Friends, where there was an argument. They are clashing as a trio to some extent. And I think he's just kind of blasting them. I think this is a classic like Sondheim mental breakdown moment. I mean, not necessarily a full-on mental breakdown, but he is ping-ponging mm-hmm. these ideas of like dreams and decisions to make in your life, but then thinking about his friends and even in like the little stanzas themselves, like just looking at like Charlie's a screamer, Charlie won't bend, Charlie's in your corner, and like the one previously, like the first two are these negative things that are very specific, mm-hmm. like, you know, being a hothead, being a won't budge, won't bend. But then like the last little bit is like, oh, he's a friend, he's in your corner, which is very simple. Yes. And basic, not specific about who Charlie is at all, not any of his like really specific good qualities, but just he's a friend and he's there. And it's interesting that Frank is in this like really negative mindset of like, here's all the intense reasons why my friends are bad, but yeah, technically they're my friends.
Here's another thing I don't like about you.
Yeah. And another, yeah, he's not saying that Charlie's like creative and, you know, open-minded and free thinking. Like he's not saying any of those things. He's just saying like, oh, he's a friend.
Yeah, I think it's fascinating the order he goes in here. Charlie gets way more descriptors put to him, but just in that first bit, a hothead won't budge, is a friend. A screamer, won't bend, is in your corner. Mary gets, is a dreamer, a friend, so he says that to both of them, is a nudge, is a purist. And then back to Charlie, who's a judge and a dropout.
Which I think is telling to like back to the original argument, whereas like, yeah, Mary's there and trying to smooth things over, but really the heat between them is Frank versus Charlie. So it makes sense
yes.
that Frank is really minded and like trying to call out Charlie of all the crap that he's doing or how he thinks that, you know, that Charlie's doing all these bad things. And then You know, he's like, well, and while I'm at it, Mary's also, you know.
Yeah.
And like, even just saying like Mary being a dreamer and Mary being a purist, like these are things that could be positive in a way, but I think he is saying very negatively.
So yeah, that's what I was going to bring up too, specifically the purist. I was like, I don't know if that's supposed to be read positively or negatively, because I could go either way.
Yeah, I don't know either. And even being a purist, I think it definitely alludes to her sort of past-minded mentalities, perhaps thinking things that should not change, and eventually goes into those ideas of why shouldn't things change and all that. But I think that alludes to that idea, perhaps.
I mean, he says that Charlie's a friend as well. Do you think it's also interesting that he gets to Mary's a friend quicker?
Yeah.
Which is, by the way, she's a friend, okay? Just a friend.
Just a friend, everybody. I'm not into her like that. I think it's interesting, too, that in all of these, he's finding reasons not to listen to them, or finding reasons why it may be bad to follow what they're saying, which is also very self-centered of like, there's, you know, I'm focused on what I want to do, and here are all the reasons coping why they aren't to be listened to. Even in thinking like Charlie is a dropout, I think that's such a big, like, especially in the arts, is like, what does success mean, and what does pursuing success mean, and what that path to success should look like. And I think Frank has this very clouded mindset of thinking that like, you have to go on this particular path, my path that I went on to find success, and Charlie having dropped out, he's not going to achieve success in a particular way. That I think Charlie is probably very happy to some extent, especially dropping out and pursuing what he wanted to pursue on paper. To I think society as a whole, U.S. society, you know, it's a very like, oh, you dropped out of college, you're a failure.
Correct me if I'm wrong. I think we're supposed to understand that Charlie did. Well, I don't know, actually. Now that I say, I was going to say that he doesn't finish high school. I don't know if he went through college or not. I was going to bring up that dropout can also mean like dropping out of society. That was a slang term used in like the 60s and 70s. Yeah, so I'm wondering if that's what he's using here too, is like he doesn't want to be a part of like the mainstream, he's trying to be like a dropout type of thing.
Oh, that is interesting. Yeah, I didn't know that that was also a term that's what that meant. But he is also that. Charlie is also like, he doesn't want to be a part of the blob.
Which, can I just say, I think I've said this on another episode too, I grew up thinking that I really wanted to go to like the fancy parties and stuff like that. And then the two times I've actually been able to go, it was like the most boring thing in the entire world, and they hated it.
it's a lot. Like, I'm sure I would try my best to be as like charismatic and fun and whatnot, but I think I would be very Charlie-like in like the parties that they were going to. Of just like, all right, I'm done. I'm out of here.
I'm out.
Thank you for the fun cocktails. I'm gone.
I've heard lasers are expensive though, so you do have to go.
Lasers are expensive. They are.
Frank continues on. So, old friends, don't you see we can have it all? Moving on, getting out of the past. Solving dreams, not just trusting them, taking dreams, readjusting them, growing up, trying things, being flexible, bending with the road, adding dreams when the others don't last, growing up, understanding that growing never ends, like old dreams, some old dreams, like old friends.
So, old friends, don't you see we can have it all? Moving on, getting out of the past. Solving dreams, not just trusting them, taking dreams, readjusting them, growing up. Growing up, trying things, being flexible, bending with the road. Adding dreams when the others don't last. Growing up, understanding that growing never ends, like old dreams, some old dreams, like old friends.
I think it's really interesting getting out of the past. The further along we go in this show, the past is pretty good. I mean, like, there are a lot of like high positive moments in the past, particularly for Frank in some ways. And I think the biggest thing that happens that is a big negative for Frank is the divorce, which is all caused by his own actions. So I'm wondering, like, what of the past is he trying to get out of? Having these good friends and pursuing the fun things that they were doing, whether they were struggling for money and opening doors, that's such a big moment of being young and pursuing your dreams and trying to make ends meet, which sucks, but I think overall it seems like they were having a good time in spite of it. So I wonder what it is that Frank is trying to get out of.
I think maybe when the mistakes are there, whether it's like the ending of his marriage, the textual thing, I guess it's here. Once again, I will bring up my theory, which I do want to admit that I may have misspoke in previous episodes as I was forming this theory, because it's kind of new for me.
Yeah.
The three main characters, both all three being obsessed with different points in time, and that being kind of their folly.
Yeah.
For me, I think Mary is stuck in the past, Charlie's stuck in the present, and Frank is stuck in the future. So anything for him is like going there, going there, going there. And I think that while he may have had fun in moments, to use a Sondheim word, he wanted to be successful. Like,
yeah.
That is all what he did. And so when he thinks back, he's like, well, I wasn't successful. I wasn't anything. I was a nobody back then. Why are we thinking about the past? Because his idea of success is like money, power, fame. That's what he wants.
Yeah. Yeah. I have to say, I really loved that theory too. I heard it on a previous episode and it clicked a lot of things into place of like where these characters are thinking. And you're right. Like, despite the fact that I think things were probably overall pretty good for Frank, despite him not being financially successful, he still is hyper-focused on the future and the possibilities of success. And I wonder too, if with this relating to being flexible, bending with the road, adding dreams when others won't last. I wonder if Frank, perhaps, does he think that he's run out of steam in a way? Like, is he worried that he's not going to continue to, I don't know, produce, or and by produce, I mean like producing art or something worthwhile or having something to pursue in the future that I think he may have previously had in the past.
I think that's the other big thing too. Like in this show specifically, he's a part of Hollywood at this point. And one of the biggest things they say is like, you're only as good as your last success.
Yeah.
So if I was like five flops ago, no one cares about you, right? It's like, what can you do for me like right now? And I think that he is internalizing that to a degree, right? Like, yeah, he's got success, but so what? So I also wanted to call that out, that Bending with the Road, of course, going back to the Merrily We Roll Along song,
yes,
because that's coming right straight from there. And how he ends this section, I spent the longest time just kind of reading and trying to internalize, because I think the actor can phrase this a little bit differently depending on how they perform it. But how it's notated is, so understanding that growing never ends, like old dreams, and then he uses the M dash, so kind of like parentheses, we want to think about these,
right,
some old dreams, end parentheses, like old friends. Essentially, like, you have to understand that growing is a continuous process, just like old dreams, just like old friends. So you have to continually change and change and change and change. It's an interesting concept that he's ending this off with.
I think that this goes back to a little bit what I wrote down for trying things and being flexible, is that these are ideas that are to some extent good, especially for an artist, like being flexible, changing, fluctuating, opening yourself to new ideas. But I don't think that's where his mindset is. Like, it's not being flexible for the sake of creating something new and exciting or adjusting what you were thinking about artistically, like, you know, 20 years ago or whatever. It's about how best to be more successful, and by successful meaning more lucrative and achieving fame and money, rather than making something substantial artistically. Like, it's like he's almost there, and I think that a lot of this song is a crossroads moment. And I think he has a lot of this mentality of what it's like to be an artist that is perhaps lingering from youth, but this idea of growing up and thinking that growing up and trying to remove yourself from childish pursuits or naive pursuits, which I think he may now understand as artistic, is perhaps his folly. I think is where Sondheim is suggesting, like, here's how he's poisoned. Like, he's so close. He's like, he's almost there, but the things that he's, I think, that are dawning on him are things that are not best for his art, but just this one desire of his, this one old dream. Not all dreams, not, you know, some old dreams.
Mm-hmm. The hard thing too is both versions of Merrily We Roll Along have a little bit of a different setup as far as what type of producer slash director he is. Because in the original production, you were supposed to understand that his latest movie that we hear about at the very beginning is bad.
Yeah.
And in the new production, that's not the case. It's actually good. So it sounds like, well, okay, so he has talent. There is something there that he's striving for. It's not just vacuous entertainment necessarily. What it isn't, I think for sure, I don't like to use this term, but like have artistic merit, you know, but it's not striving for like a deeper meaning or something like that.
Yeah.
And this gets into the hard thing because it's like, I don't even think you need to have that to be a good artist. It's like if you're, anyways, that's a whole other conversation. But I think the biggest thing is because Charlie is stuck in the present, hey, when are we doing Going Left? When are we going to do Going Left to Frank, that's like, well, that's the past. But I think he has enough awareness to be like, if I tell Charlie that, it will crush him. Yeah. If I just straight up say, no, we're not doing this.
Yeah. And I think it's really interesting too how he does say that being flexible is something that he thinks that he's really good at and that Charlie is not doing. You know, he says Charlie won't budge, Charlie won't bend. Where I think Charlie has been bending quite a bit, you know.
That's like, true. That is true.
You know,
yeah.
I think Charlie has been forced to compromise some of his own morals for the sake of Frank's success that I don't think Frank has really recognized. Like, I think Frank is thinking like, oh, I've bent what my priorities are and what it is that I want to pursue. I don't understand why you're not bending the same way that I am.
You're telling me Franklin Shepherd, the composer of Musical Husbands, what to do? All right. So this is when Gussie makes her appearance. So, you know, Frank is struggling with all of these concepts. I still think at this point, we're still, as an audience, think he's going to go and see his friends.
Yeah.
Oh, and there is a bit of a book scene I should just mention here, just for people who don't know, which is she's come out and says, like, I have completely told my husband what's going on. I'm leaving him. I'm only going to be with you now.
Yes.
We can be out in the open about our affair.
Yes. And phrasing it too, saying, like, I left him for me. When Frank was like, you know, don't leave him for me. And she's like, no, I left him for me. You know, I made the decision myself without you, supposedly.
Let's talk about Gussie here a little bit more in depth here in just a second, yes. Because I just this a lot about like double speak, I think.
Yep.
She sings, life is knowing what you want, darling. That's the only thing to know. As I told you moons ago, darling, nothing wrong with wanting. Nothing wrong with wanting me, darling. Also nothing wrong with not. Though it's only fair that you should be aware that I want you a lot.
Life is knowing what you want. Darling, that's the only thing to know. As I told you moons ago, darling, nothing wrong with wanting. Nothing wrong with wanting me, darling. Also nothing wrong with not. Though it's only fair that you should be aware that I want you a lot.
That's how I introduce myself on Tinder now, actually, is just this entire refrain.
Yeah. Well, honestly, I think a lot of how she is talking, I mean, the music and the phrasing that she's using, it's very seductive. And it's very seductive in a way that is not overtly seductive. She is being so coy seeming and like on paper saying like, I'm just saying, you know, there's nothing wrong with wanting in general, but it's also nothing wrong with wanting.
It's like the people honestly, it's like, I'm just asking questions. I'm not saying what I think. I'm just saying things.
Yes, that's exactly what this whole like section of her is her just quote unquote saying, I'm just saying this. There's no baggage here at all. And I think that pairing of there's nothing wrong with wanting, there's nothing wrong with wanting me, darling. There are a lot of like little couplets of lines that I think in her part of the song that really nail home that she is being very particular with her words and really specific on what she's trying to say. Also saying them in a way that's seemingly unmoored, you know what I mean?
Because I've recorded all these episodes out of order, I'm going to do a little bit of foreshadowing for a future episode. Something I asked the guest on that one, but I'm going to ask you now too. Do you think Gussie is the villain of the piece? Is she the antagonist of the piece? Is that what we're supposed to read into this?
I literally had that question written down. Is
oh, really?
Gussie the villain? Is she the villain, or does she represent something larger that is perhaps villainous? And I think to some extent, both. I think this mm-hmm. perhaps is the first time in this show that we are realizing that Gussie has other plans and is perhaps seductive to a particular mm-hmm. mindset or this argument that I don't think we're fully aware of yet. I mean, like, we see Gussie first as being a scorned wife. She lashes out in that way, which is like, ooh, that was intense.
I get it.
Yeah.
Throw that iodine. I get it.
Yeah, exactly.
But I think this is the first moment where even like the music is sending very clear signals of this is not just seduction for the sake of romantic and sexual seduction, but it is seduction to ideas mm-hmm. that are perhaps contrary to what Frank may want.
This is my reading, just to throw my two cents into this. I think from this point on throughout the show, we are definitely shown that Gussie knowingly seduces Frank to do certain things that she wants.
Yeah.
Like, this is not like by mistake. She knows what she wants. She goes after it and she makes him do things. So in that case, yes, you could like read that villainous part in it. But I'd also like to say, like, it is a little bit almost easy to do that because yeah. the way the show is also structured, if it wasn't Gussie, it was going to be somebody else. I think Frank was just geared to want to be seduced into money, power, fame.
I think you're totally right. I think she's just perhaps the very specific person that Frank came into contact with. And we see how ambitious and how she says later on in Growing Up Part 2 that she is very patient and she knows what she wants and she will take her time to go and get it, which is perhaps villainous seeming, especially coming off of the character of Mrs. Lovett. You know, like, we were introduced to these characters, and particularly Mrs. Lovett as a character that was, I think, very conniving and patient and goes after what she wants and isn't necessarily aggressive or demanding about what she wants, but is very sly about getting it. So I think it's easy for us to think that she is a villainous character, but I think overall that greed, mm-hmm. the blob, is a villain. I think she is just the person that Frank is introduced to.
This is how the song ends here, where she says, growing up means admitting the things you want the most. Can't pursue every possible line. Folding tents, making choices, ignoring all other voices, including mine, you're divine. You decide on what you want, darling, not on what you think you should. Not on what you want, darling, not from force of habit. Once it's clearly understood, darling, better go and grab it. Things can slip away for good, darling. What is it you really...
Growing up means admitting the things you want the most. Can't pursue every possible line. Folding tents, making choices, ignoring all other voices, including mine. You're divine. You decide on what you want, darling, not on what you think you should. Not on what you want to want, darling, not from force of habit. Once it's clearly understood, darling, better go and grab it. Can slip away for good, darling. What is it you really?
Perfectly vague with a lot of these phrases,
yes.
Like admitting the things you want the most. Like, what things do you mean, Gussie? Like,
yeah.
You know,
they are at odds a little bit with how they define growing up. Growing up, as Frank has said in the first half of this song, is like admitting, like, the reality and, like, mm-hmm. you know, putting away childish things type of thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Whereas hers is like, no, it's just what you saying what you want and then going after what you want.
Yeah,
which is not quite the same thing,
right? She does, like, see what she wants, and she goes and gets it. Like, she took mm-hmm. her time to really go and get it, and thinking that that's how it should be done for everybody. I also wonder, too, I don't know, like, obviously, like, the beginning part of the song that Frank is singing, it's very, you know, it's internal monologue type, but, like, a lot of this is feeding off of these ideas that perhaps he has thought about before or expressed to her before, because she seems to be like, oh, I see where you're struggling. Let me guide you along the way of ideas mm-hmm. of decide on what you want, even in saying you decide on what you want. It's not him really deciding. She is guiding him very specifically, but thinking that he has a choice there and ignoring all other voices and thinking that, like, he is very tied at this point between thinking about Marion and Charlie and, you know, Gussie and Fame. And she's saying, ignore all the other voices, including mine, but also here's my two cents.
Can I ask you just like the dumbest question here? Because I don't understand what folding tents means. I truly don't know what she means by that. I understand that she's not talking about like camping tents. Like, I think she's meaning like a tent, like you're tenting something, like folding it. But like, I don't understand what that means in the context of her line here.
I think not raising tents, but putting them down. Because in the context of everything else, can't pursue every possible line, making choices, ignoring all other voices. I think she's very specifically saying, like, you can't have everything. You can't have a full, like, carnival of tents. Right. Like, there's only perhaps one that you should be under, maybe two. How I read it is folding all the ones that are excessive.
Interesting. I have to admit here, too, that this whole ending bit, like, as funny as it sounds when you read it out, you decide what you want, not on what you think you should, not on what you want to want. At the risk of oversharing, and I understand that this is now me putting a lot of personal baggage out here, but as someone who, like, had this, like, mental breakdown coming to terms with their own sexuality, like, this is such, cuts you deep a little bit, for me at least. Yeah, is this what I want, or is this what society has told me that I want to want? And that whole thing, like, makes you, like, crumble in on yourself if you think about it too hard.
Yeah, I also really intensely underline those two lines, not on what you want to want, not from force of habit. I think that's that's such a big idea, to your point of talking about sexuality, but I also thought about pursuing dreams and artistic passions of, like, there is that moment of when you start to realize something that is so totally against what you thought your life was about or what it should be about, that massively crumbles what your expectations of what your life is going to be. And to your point, I experienced the same thing in my own sexuality of, like, once I realized I saw this one classmate of mine who was really attractive, and I thought, shit, you know, just like, no, it's, I was so used to the comfort and the habit of what my life was supposed to be like, that the crumbling of that, or the possibility of crumbling that, was terrifying and daunting. And I think with art in particular too, I think once you have this dream or this want or this desire for so long, sometimes it starts to wear on you or becomes, I don't want to say stale, but not as flashy anymore. And I think there's a moment of, like, do I still want this? Do I still want to pursue this? Is this still something that is worthwhile to me? Or is it just, I've done it for so long, I don't know anything else? Which I think in this particular case, Gussie is really feeding on that idea of, like, you know, you've been doing this particular thing for so long, or you've been friends with these people for so long. Are you still friends with them because you genuinely want to? Or is it just because you've been friends with them for so long?
To bring it into that art realm a little bit more, one of the negative things about the internet, and there's only a couple.
Only a few.
But one of the negative, one of the negative things about the internet is, like, this desire for consensus around art, which really frustrates me. And it goes both ways, right? Because someone can come out and be like, you know what, I didn't like, you know, insert popular thing or thing that everyone is enjoying. Or the other way, it's like, I really like this thing that everyone seemingly hates, and these are the reasons why. And people like, how could you possibly, like, go against the grain? It's like, well, yeah, it's like, it is art. You can have your own interpretations and your own reasonings when you come into that sort of thing. But people just want you to, like, adhere to what everyone else is wanting to like or not like.
Yeah. Which I think very ironically ties into the ideas of the blob and where Gussie is coming from, of, like, as a group consensus, we are following this thing. And even, like, thinking about this show overall, like, it was negatively reviewed by critics, but as you had stated before, in that, like, really crappy recording on YouTube, like, people were having a great time watching it. Like, the general audiences were seemingly enjoying it.
So any last things you want to say about this song?
I think this song is in particular is very rife with moments that Sondheim then uses better in other shows. I see there are so many, like I said previously, there are so many moments where I think he's toying at ideas and ways of writing and ways of grappling with an issue or a topic that I think he needed this song and this show as a way to sort of sketch it out, and then to say, okay, that wasn't fully right, or like that didn't display, I think, to the full extent of what I could say about this idea. now let me do it better in Sunday and Into the Woods, and very, very Sondheim-esque, especially that last little bit that Gussie sings of tongue twistery,
and he does the very classic Sondheim thing where she doesn't say the final word.
Yep.
Where you are meant to fill in what she's going to say. Yep. So,
and in a lot of productions, I think she also hums. She does a little. It's also very interesting, Kyle, that you brought me to this song, because I see so similar to the character of Mrs. Lovett, and back to our original conversation, first of talking about the introduction of Mrs. Lovett. So I guess I'm just tied to these very conniving women that Sondheim writes.
Every conniving woman I'll have you back on the show for. So
sounds great.
To wrap things up here, I mean, first and foremost, so if you were to give a rating of the entire score of Merrily We Roll Along, growing up, would that show up in like your top five, middle five, bottom five? What do you think it would rank?
I think at first it didn't grab me. And I think a lot of the score didn't really grab me. But the more that I've listened to this song in particular, the more I've like read into the lyrics and how they're written, I definitely think that this is probably the top five. I think lyrically, I think there are a lot of songs musically that I'm much more engaged with. I definitely think Not a Day Goes By is at the top of the list, and it'll stay there.
So let's pretend that I have constructed a time machine, but it's a very weirdly constructed time machine because it can only do one thing, which is take us back in time to go and see a Broadway show that you have not seen before.
Yeah.
What show would we go back in time and see?
I thought a whole lot about this, and I think my answer is a little cheeky in a way. But I really would love to see the 1998 revival of Cabaret.
Oh, yeah.
Which was Alan Cumming. It was not his first go at being MC, but it had Natasha Richardson as Sally.
Yes.
I would love to really go back there. I would love to like scrub my brain of that production, because there is a recording of a production of that, but not with those roles. But I would love to see Natasha Richardson be Sally. I think that would be so intense. And I would love to just be floored and have a very like blank mind at seeing that production of Cabaret in person.
It's so interesting too, because like nowadays that's almost the go-to version when people put it on. But at the time, like I remember even at the time, it's like, this is pretty bold to go this wild.
Bold, it's grungy, it's you know, nasty, it's punky. Like I would have really enjoyed that, like just going in completely blind of the production in general and just going off of what I think the vibes are going to be. And my sort of also other answer that without the caveat of it being a Broadway production is I would love to go and see, I don't remember where it was, but it was definitely off Broadway or out of New York, but the production of Hunchback of Notre Dame with Patrick Page. That show really gives me chills.
Can I just say something about Hunchback?
Yes.
Which is, I don't even know how much of a hot take this is anymore. I just know that I got so many side eyes growing up when I made the proclamation that I think it's the best musical score of any Disney animated movie.
Yeah.
Like, hands down is the best score. I love Ashman and Menken, right? And their scores that they made. But just as a complete finished score, Hunchback is like so top tier that there's nothing even close to it for me.
Yes. It like, and you know, definitely listening to, I that was a movie, one of the cartoon movies that I did not really watch as a kid. I only like discovered it later on. But then like the actual like full on cast, like live production with a full chorus and just swelling and intense full orchestras, like I get goosebumps so often listening to the recording. I cannot imagine being in the theater watching that.
Right.
And like
when he hits that high note at the very beginning, so I'm like, how are you going that high?
It's amazing, like the bells, the music, the chord, like it's just something else. And it's probably just my Catholic trauma being itched there, but you know.
Lucas, this has been so much fun. If people wanted to stay in contact with you, what's the easiest way to do so?
My artist Instagram is probably the best, which is lucas.j.rougeux. It's my full name. I also have a website where you can check me out. Thank you so much, Kyle. This was so much fun. Thank you for dragging me back and make me watch Merrily. What other shows are you going to make me watch?
We'll figure it out.
We'll figure something out, yeah.
Thanks so much for listening. You can send emails to puttingittogetherpodcast@gmail.com, and you can also follow Sondheim Podcast on Twitter and Instagram. You can also support the show on Patreon by going to patreon.com/puttingittogetherpodcast. Thank you to the Alberta Podcast Network, to Alberta Blue Cross, and to Connect First Credit Union this week. Putting It Together is available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and pretty much anywhere you can get podcasts from. Consider subscribing so that you never miss an episode. Next week, we're going to be talking about Not a Day Goes By. That's right, you can expect a podcast, just another blessed podcast. As always, a big thank you to the great Chris Taniguchi, who designed the podcast artwork, and Nick Driscoll for composing our theme music. Well, we've reached the end of our episode. Yes, I know. Goodbye for now.